So, good evening, participants. So, we will start. So, yesterday there were a few things that I spoke to you about, and I hope that you have some questions. So, you would like to make sure that you have learnt it properly. So, may I have the questions, please, if at all you have any, or did you not think about it at all? Any questions? Okay, it looks like you don't have questions. But if you have questions, be ready with the questions. You type it and keep it. And so when I ask, you just have to press enter. So the question comes in. So, okay, we have already spoken about a few things. And I thought today, instead of actually speaking about public speaking, let me speak to you about interpersonal speaking skills, in the sense between two people. So I told you that today's session was also going to be about public speaking. So interpersonal speaking skills is also between a person and his audience. That could be one-on-one, or it could be one and the audience in great numbers, or maybe one and a few people. So many people say that, you know, it's a two-way communication. I don't believe that it's a two-way communication. It's either one-way communication or multi-ways of communication. Because nowadays what happens is that when you talk, that you could have so many other information that's coming in also, like you're referring to material. The material also is giving, but maybe people could also be giving feedback. Nowadays people have teleprompters, so that, you know, from teleprompter also people are getting information and people are in turn giving information. I also request people who want to listen to this lecture to pay attention to be able to, you know, get advantage from it. Otherwise that, you know, you would just listen to the lecture and you may not greatly benefit. Please understand this is a free talk and this is for your advantage. And you would be able to benefit certainly if you can pay attention and listen to the points and also take down notes. That's what I would like to suggest. So as I told you, for any communication, the most important thing is the purpose or the objective. You should know that, you know, what you have to communicate. See, for example, if my purpose is to only communicate to people, look, it's going to rain, so please go indoors. Okay, I have to do that. I have to tell my neighbor. Okay, so maybe the neighbor already knows about it. So why would I tell that to that neighbor? Or maybe the neighbor is just, you know, a little inside the house, cannot see the clouds, but I'm actually outside. I can see, maybe I've seen the weather report. So I would say, please go indoors so that, or rather stay indoors. Okay, it's going to rain. So if the neighbor is outside and I'm outside and both of us are looking at the sky and both of us know that it's going to rain, and if I say, please go into the house, it's going to rain, what does it mean? What would it mean? It would just mean that I think that I'm the most intelligent person and the other person is not. And I don't think that the neighbor would want to speak to me after that. The same way, like if I want to teach a 10th standard kid what he has already learnt in the 9th standard, I'm sure no kid would be interested to, unless he has to actually learn it for a specific reason. So it's all about the purpose of communication. In the sense, you should know what you have to communicate and why you have to communicate. Okay, that's, these two things are extremely important before you communicate. Somebody asks you to go on the stage and they say, could you please come on the stage and speak to some people? I think the simple question would be is that, I mean, should I be speaking and what should I be speaking and why should I be speaking? And then I think everything else becomes easy. So the same thing about even having a conversation with a friend too. Sometimes you can't just have a, come, let's just talk. What can we talk about? We just talk about anything. If the friend is not interested in talking about just anything, because nobody wants to waste time. So you would be seen as a bore because, you know, you just want to waste somebody else's time. Even with a friend, people want to speak about something that's enriching or something that's actually you know, exhilarating, something that's actually pleasant. So you can't expect people to, you know, just give their time to you, because that's the most important thing. People are giving their time to you, and time is money. See, for example, your parents, if at all you're a student, go to office, and even if you're a professional, you're going to office, you're giving your time for a job, and you're paid for your time. You understand? In the sense, I work for 26 days, I work for 30 days, I work from morning to evening. In the sense, basically, more than how much you have worked, you're talking about, you know, how much time you've actually given. So even when somebody has a conversation with you, they're giving their time to you. So you should value that time. So you should have a purpose for your communication. For example, you say a friend is just passing by and you see, okay, the person's friend is going on a cycle and you're on the roadside, you're on the footpath. You say, hey, okay. And the friend says, okay, hey, or hi, or whatever. Then you say, you know, come, I want to talk to you. Certainly, a friend, so what do you want to talk about? In the sense, you know, nobody wants to simply say, hello, how is the weather? How was the sunshine today? How is the dust here? How is, you know, COVID spreading? You know, you can't have such inane conversations if you are not really related to that subject. You understand? Yes, you could actually perhaps say that, oh, I was worried about you. Somebody told that, you know, you're unwell. So are you all right? And of course, that's a valid conversation. Or you could say that, you know, I'm really worried about when the school is going to open, when the college is going to open, when the office is going to open. That's a valid conversation. But if you're going to say that, hi, come, let's talk. And when the person comes, I don't know what to talk. Let's talk something. Okay. And nobody would know what to talk. And the next time your friend would start avoiding you, and he would not, he or she would not be a friend anymore. So please remember that you should be very clear about the purpose of your communication before you start communication. Somebody may say, do we have to think about all that before we talk, have everyday conversations? You should. Because if you don't want to be a failure in your communication, if you don't want to be a failure as a person, you should do these small jobs. The same thing, even if your father, you're just sitting in your room, your father calls you, okay, Akash, you know, come. Okay, Papa, I've come. You know, let's have a conversation. Sometimes you're worried because your father wants to talk about your performance in school or what you've done somewhere else. You're really, because your father has the purpose. If he says, let's just talk about something, okay, that's too, is fine. Maybe your father just wants to have a conversation with you. Father says, you know, I don't know what to talk, you know, just think up something. You certainly will think that your father is absolutely jobless. You understand? So whether even it's a conversation in a formal setting or in school, colleges, in social settings, or even at home, in your bedroom, your dining room, everywhere the conversation has to have a purpose. Either it's a big purpose or a small purpose, at least some purpose. Otherwise, it's going to become very difficult for you to remain as a good communicator. You know, like another thing is that even sometimes that you know what is the purpose, but you may not know how to start. For example, you want to go and ask your, you know, father or your mother or someone for something. Okay, let's just take an example. For example, Sai Krishna wants to ask his father for some money. Maybe he's not bold enough to ask the money, so he may not know how to ask. Maybe he knows, you know, what to ask. He knows the purpose of his communication, but he doesn't know how to go about it. He can't just go and say, father is doing something. Papa, I need some money. Most often, you know what is the answer for that. But if you want the money, that should be the purpose. My purpose is to ask for money is a different matter. But if you decide that my purpose is to get the money, then you'll have to plan the conversation in a different way. If your purpose is to just ask for the money, Papa, I need some money. Papa might say, I can't give you money. The conversation is over. But if your purpose is to get the money, then the conversation is something else. For instance, you may not even start by asking, I need some money. You may actually start by saying, you know, this happened, that happened. And, you know, you may actually build a case. Okay. And then in the end, you may actually make your father realize that it's important for him to give you money. or somebody else to give you something, and then you actually make it very clear that you need money. So that is how you ensure your communication is structured around the purpose. So even if you're on the stage, you're speaking to the audience, if your purpose is just to talk, nobody will understand. But if your purpose is to get to people so that they will understand what you're speaking, then it's structured in a very different way altogether. And when you speak also, for example, you want some money, you go and ask, okay, you build the case and you say, but if you're not very sure if you really need that money or not, you'll not be convinced enough to convince somebody else. So you will have to be very careful that whether you have the strength of the purpose. You got it? You need to be worried about the strength of the purpose to be able to execute that purpose. So you should know, okay, if you say that, you know, I'm going to ask, I'm going to convince, if I don't get it, it's all right, that's a different matter. But if you say, I really need it, so I really need to convince, I need to do everything to get it, but then the way you structure your communication also would be different. And another thing is that most of your information comes from listening to your listener or your partner in communication, or what they call in formal terms, the stakeholders. In a communication, there are stakeholders, the speaker and the listener, or both are speakers and both are listeners, or maybe the speaker and the audience. So when you're talking about the stakeholders, you have to listen. Oh, somebody may say, I'm speaking from a stage. How can I listen to the audience? Yes, if you're speaking and your audience are murmuring, they are busy doing something else, they're not interested in you, you have to be hearing that too. They're making a lot of noise. That's a very clear sign that, you know, maybe they're not paying attention to you. So it's not just speaking to the person in front of you, just two of you, and you're listening to the other person. But even listening is not just about listening to the sounds, but also listening in the sense, in very figuratively, what do you say, reading their body language and listening to their emotions and listening to their response is also as important as listening to their words directly aimed at you. So you have to listen. When you listen, you will know very clearly whether they are interested or not, and whether they are in tune with what you're saying or not, because ultimately you'll have to execute your purpose. And another thing is that you have to comprehend. It's not sufficient that you are listening, but you need to comprehend, you need to understand, you need to grasp what the other person is trying to say to be able to. For example, you know, there are times that, you know, you go somewhere and, you know, you start talking to someone and the person is not responding. And after a while, you realize that person is not even related, because maybe the person was trying to tell you that I'm not part of this. But, you know, you say, no, but, you know, I think this is the person, and you continue because you have decided to speak. You deciding to speak is nothing to do with another person wanting to listen. So first, you also need to listen to try to find out whether that person is responding properly. This is how it works. Next is that you have to pay attention to what your listener is saying, so that, you know, you will be able to grasp it much better. Then another thing is that you have to also look and sound interested. Very important. Nobody would speak to you if at all you have a very callous attitude, you have a very snooty attitude, you say that I'm going to speak and you have to listen kind of thing. You have to basically look and sound interested in your audience. If you have a very condescending attitude, in the sense you think that I am a great speaker, this is me communicating, and even if you're going to give an instruction to a servant, you have to be sounding very interested and pertinent, because otherwise you will just, you know, get it over his head, because, you know, his or her head, because, you know, people may not be actually paying attention to you. Sometimes some people naturally can't pay attention, because maybe since they're very young, they may be having attention deficiency, so that they may not be able to pay attention even if they want to. So you have to be very careful that you have to sound interested, so they at least, you know, respect you and they will listen to you very carefully. For example, even if you're telling someone, you say, come here, may I tell you this? You know, look, it's like, I want you to do this kind of a thing. You make it very pertinent so that your listener would be able to take it very seriously. That is what it is. And another thing is, I spoke about voice. See, it's very important for you to know your voice. Most people don't know their voice. Many people don't know that they have a weak voice. Some people don't know that they have a loud voice. Some people don't know they have a very husky voice. Some people don't know that they have a crackling voice. Some people don't know that they have a hoarse voice. So you have to know your voice so that, you know, you can actually work it better. If at all your voice is naturally not pleasant, then, you know, you should work on it to see that, you know, how it will not tear into the ears of your listeners so that, you know, they don't get so irritated with your voice, so that you have to work on the voice. If you have very pleasant voice, sometimes you can't say very serious things. You can't express your anger, so that, you know, sometimes you have to modulate the voice in such a way that, you know, that pleasantness goes away. If you have a very weak voice, you have to actually work on it and make it a little stronger. If at all it is a very loud voice, you may have to work on the volume, because you don't have to shout. People don't like to be shouted at, you know, unless you're a person in authority or they're used to you shouting. So you have to really work. Sometimes voice is the culprit. You may be a very interesting speaker, but people can't listen to your voice. I'm telling you, a long time ago, I used to have a teacher who was an extraordinary teacher, but she had a shrill voice. And the problem is that she was such a nice teacher, and this was a problem that everybody had with her. Like, you know, she also knew it, but maybe I was too young to tell her that, you know, that maybe she had to work on her voice. But that was becoming very difficult, that, you know, people were not able to listen to her for too long because it almost gave a headache. That is why you have to be worried about your voice. Most people don't pay attention. See, sometimes, like I told you the day before, people are in a restaurant and, you know, they are like, you know, screaming and speaking so loudly without even knowing that they are being very incivil. So you have to know that, you know, you are making a mistake by not watching your voice. You have to work on your voice. You should monitor your voice and you should modulate your voice, which is extremely important. And then you have to work on the style of speaking. For example, some people can speak like a drone, like, you know, na 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 na, you know, I went there, then this happened, and that happened, then I was there for some time, and, you know, it's like, it's almost like a lullaby. You're just putting somebody to sleep, and it could be extremely boring, or it could be absolute monotony in the sense, you know, the tone is like, you know, I want to do this, like, okay, then this happened, okay, and I was there, then this happened, okay, like this, so that the same pattern, the tone doesn't change at all. So you'll have to actually change the tone. You know, it should be multi-tone instead of being monotone. So you will have to, you know, sometimes if at all you're saying something, you could have some variations. They say voice modulation. You can't do unnecessary voice modulation. Voice modulation has to be done very specifically. Only then the voice modulation will work. Like, for instance, when you're saying, like I said, very specifically, because I want to emphasize on that. Then I say very specifically. I can't say very specifically and simply modulating. You can't do unnecessary modulation. For that, you need to have a lot of training. So you will have to work on that. You know, you have to work on, you have to train yourself to modulate your voice. And you should know where to emphasize and where not to emphasize. You got it? You can't just emphasize at the wrong place. Where to emphasize? No, where to emphasize and where not to emphasize. You got it? So you need to know where to stress. The stressing on the words is also very important that we do extensively when we work with students and professionals in a very close setting when we do a workshop. And then the other thing is that when you're listening to somebody, sometimes, you know what you're speaking, but you may sound very indifferent. You yourself sound like, you know, you're not very interested, but you can't be. When you're talking, that is your personality. So if you're sounding like, you know, you're not you're aloof, like you're indifferent. It doesn't matter to you what happens. You may be a big guy, but you know, I don't think that you know you will be an effective communicator. So you'll have to be very careful about how you sound pertinent. You can't be indifferent. Then the next thing is that don't be condescending. Don't look down upon somebody who is listening just because they are paying attention to you. You'll have to pay undue attention to people who are paying attention to you. And you have to respect your audience. When you respect your audience, in the sense, respect in the sense, not about, you know, please, you know, kowtowing or like in bowing to them or, you know, saying like, you know, please, sir, ma'am, and whatever. I'm saying that what you should, you know, respect, you should accept that they are your audience and you should accept the fact that they're listening to you and you should pay attention to them and you should pay that, you know, at least that minimum respect to them. Then always the most important thing is, unless the speaking duration is fixed, like some people tell you they speak for about half an hour, speak for about 20 minutes, speak for about 3 minutes, or you yourself know that you don't have the whole day, even with a friend, that you can't speak. Sometimes it gets boring to anybody, even to your own parents, even to your own wife, husband, anybody, so that you need to actually do it in installments. If somebody has survived the first installment, go for the second installment. When they've survived the second installment, go to the third installment. It's like that. So don't speak too much at a time just because you're a good speaker. Then the mastery is about, you know, keeping it simple. They say, like I keep saying, that Mahatma Gandhi was a very effective speaker because people accepted him. People were able to listen to him. People wanted to listen to him. And one of the great things about him is, like they say, the greatness of this man was his simplicity. In a sense, the simpler is your communication, the simpler is your message, the simpler is your way of speaking, the better it is, because it is understood by more people. The more bombastic it is, the more grandiose it is, the more embellished it is, the more difficult it becomes for a common man to understand you. So you have to work on making it simple. Simple doesn't mean stupid. Simple only means you have simplified it. Like, you know, some people explain COVID in a very simple way. They're saying the same thing, but they're saying it in a way, in a very simple way, by using very simple examples, by comparing it to everyday life. So you're understanding the same thing, but in a very easy way. Simple is making it easy for somebody to accept or understand. And then clarity. If you think that by making it complex that, you know, you're going to sound like a very big guy, no, you should be very clear. So the more clear you are, the better it's going to be for you. And then yesterday I was telling about, you know, the WH words, you know, why, what, who, where, when, which, and then how, you know, how. So you should know that, you know, why the communication, what is the communication, with whom is the communication, when is the communication. You can't actually, you have a beautiful story, you can't wake up your friend at 5 o'clock in the morning when he or she is sleeping and say, oh, I have a wonderful story to tell you. I'm sure you're going to get a slap if at all you wake the person up at 5 o'clock when the person is in deep sleep. So when is also very important, even if it's the most wonderful story in the world. Then how to say it, for example, then, okay, you stand and you start doing, oh, once upon a time and all that, you know, people say, just shut up and go away, because, you know, you are like sounding absolutely rude. This is not the way to speak, kind of a thing. So you need to be very careful about why, what, who, where, when, which, so on. And then ultimately, you have to keep this rule in your mind. This is basically coined by Verbattle. It's the pamper. Okay, pamper. What is it, pamper? Purpose. Very importantly, the purpose. And then the who is the audience. So who are you going to be speaking? Whether it's a friend, whether it's some formal, setting, whether it's a business, conversation, whether it is an academic conversation, or say purpose, audience, then the medium, which language you're going to use, what tone you're going to use, how you're going to carry the language and so on. Then the process, how you're actually going to communicate. Then the execution, how you're going to actually ensure that the communication has got completed, that not just you're speaking, it's even received properly. And ultimately, resolution. After doing all that, you have to know that, you know, whether you've been able to achieve your purpose. So it's pamper. So that this is something that we do in the training program. So you kept it all in your mind. So you heard about effective communication. There's nothing more to this. This is just this. So you have to work on your understanding of your purpose. You should know how to understand your audience. You should know how to actually work on your voice and your language and your communication and so on. Then you should know that how you're going to speak it. Then you have to know that, you know, how you're going to ensure that, you know, that the whole process of speaking and you wanting to communicate your purpose gets done. And then whether the audience have been able to receive it properly and whether they have responded, whether they've been able to utilize and so on. That is how the whole process of effective communication takes place. So keep that in mind for you to be a very, very effective communicator. So then this question from Suhan, sir, what happens to us? What makes us sound confident when we speak? What makes us confident when we speak? What makes us confident? Knowing it. See, for example, confidence is not what that can be taught, I think. It should come only from conviction. In the sense, I've also seen sometimes, ordinary people, when they are put through a lot of stress, difficulty, they can speak to even the CM of the state. You understand? They will talk so confidently because then they realize that they're completely convinced with themselves that they can actually say that. That is how confidence comes, being so sure of yourself. You know what you're saying is the right thing and you know you can say it the way you want to say it. That makes it, makes you, and that makes you confident. So, Suhan, so confidence comes from your conviction, from being so sure that what you're going to say and what you have to say is right. Okay, so, and as long as you know that, you know, you're not harming anybody, you're not, disadvantaging anybody, I think you can be just confident as long as you're not doing anything illegal. Okay, and in a democracy, you can question, you can talk to anybody, but you have to just know in your heart that, you know, what you're doing is the right thing. That's how it actually works. Okay, any other question? So all these things are done in a more elaborate manner when we do a workshop and, you know, when we plan things in a systematic way in the training program. So if anyone is interested, you may actually participate in our training programs. Hope this was helpful to you and hope that you were able to benefit from this. And if there is any last question, you may actually ask immediately so I'd be able to answer and close the session. So I hope that you understood very clearly that we have to be paying attention to the purpose, the audience, the medium of communication, the process of communication, the execution of communication, and the resolution in communication. So that is how you're going to ensure that, you know, your communication becomes extremely effective. There's nothing more to this. It is just this. You have to just work on this, and that's how it's going to be beneficial to you. So I hope that you have been able to take advantage of this class and you have learned something, and hope it was useful to you. Thank you for participating and all the best. Take care. And now they've also found out that you don't have to be having a cough or sore throat or fever. Now the new symptoms of COVID is that you can have red eyes and you can have dry mouth and you could have, dysentery and things like that, some gastrointestinal problems. So be very, very careful about your health. So if you stay safe, you can actually attend more workshops and become an effective communicator and all that. And one of the problems is that the system, the government system, I think should have actually communicated more effectively for people to actually take care, but that's not happened. So at least you people can become effective communicators in telling people around you to be more careful, to stay away from COVID and to be safe. Thank you, Sai Krishna, and thank you, Suhan. Of course, you can join the workshop and you can be in touch with Verbattle on the helpline that you know and go through the website. And thank you, all of you. May you become good communicators and may you be good for the world. Thank you once again. Bye.